Welcome to Madrid. We are now at the end of IHAD 2018, and what we are going to try and do is give you a summary of all of the talks that we found interesting in as short a time as possible. We understand that everybody's busy, so this is just a brief overview of the conference, and we are going to produce the EHC new products newsletter. We're going to also be in the newsletter with the blogs
and the NEHL brochure
and the NEHL news soon. So, okay. So, firstly, from my perspective, you know, one of the most interesting things was the hepatitis C virus talk, and not forgetting those patients.
Yes, and it was provocatively titled, Can We Forget About Hepatitis C? And the answer actually was yes, but you have to remember that a risk for hepatocellular carcinoma remains, even in people who achieved SVR, and especially if there was liver cirrhosis before getting on the therapy. So it's important to monitor.
Another talk that I found particularly interesting was the economics talk, which gave a very good overview of where we're at in terms of monitoring quality of life, looking at expectations for the future in terms of how we pay for hemophilia treatment and how we go forward with gene therapy.
And importantly, highlighted were our very own partners program.
Yes, it was great. It was great to see the program such well received and to see such movement going forward. One of the topics that I thought was very interesting was the intracranial hemorrhage talk.
Oh yes, to me that was one of the greatest highlights of that day. It was a very compelling talk because this sort of goes under the radar, the intracranial hemorrhage, among the many problems that we deal with. And it's really important if you come to think about it, 20-40% mortality among people with hemophilia who suffer intracranial bleed. So it goes to show that you have to do your best to prevent it. And one of the best ways is to first be on prophylaxis and second, keep in check additional risk factors such as hypertension, which is prevalent in the population of people with hemophilia.
Yeah. I would also like to add in, based on the women's survey that EHC is carrying out this year, that the talk from Dr. Suzanne on the women and bleeding was really, really good, very comprehensive, and the importance of heavy menstrual bleeding and the impact on carriers, von Willebrand's patients, Glanzmann's patients, and how we need to do more to try and improve care for women with bleeding disorders. You were at the SLAM session this morning.
I was at the SLAM session, and to me the greatest highlight of that session was that talk on factor 9 administered subcutaneously, which was a great potential for that drug. The results of the early trial results, phase 1-2, so this is very early in development. But you know, to me, the most compelling thing was the degree to which the half-life was extended, and not just because how the drug was modified to achieve that, but also because of the very mode of administration. Mm-hmm. Actually, the subcutaneous administration extends the half-life from 27 to 63.5 hours. So it shows a great potential for subcutaneous factor 9.
And of course, we had the last session then of the day, which was primarily on the gene therapies, and it's very exciting to see such progress so quickly and so many studies, 2021, between hemophilia A and hemophilia B.
Oh yes, the very fact that we have an entire session now devoted to gene therapy is amazing, and the results that have so far been achieved are really mesmerizing in terms of the curative potential of these therapies.
And one of my particular interests and that I have liked to see in the inclusion of the phase 3 trials is inclusion of patients with HIV, which is really very important for our community going forward.
Yes, one of the important points of the talks was that the investigators are really brainstorming on the ways to overcome some of the obstacles that are known, such as the pre-existing immunity against the AAV vectors. Most of the trials that are advanced rely on these viral vectors to deliver the drug, mm-hmm. basically to achieve the therapeutic effect. And it's important that there are ideas developed to overcome pre-existing immunity, which is a problem in a large portion of the population.
And Dr. Lily Krebs presentation as well. It was excellent, very comprehensive overview of all of the current SHLs, extended half-lives, and the call at the end for large trials for genetic testing. Do you want to comment on that?
Yes, and in terms of, yes, basically this talk and yesterday's talk on immunogenicity of products by Samantha Gao, which was also a great one, very comprehensive overview of all the potential factors contributing to immunogenicity of products. There are, I think, two takeaways. One is, despite all the efforts put into settling this thing, this is still sort of up in the air.
Mm-hmm.
And the second is the project proposed by David Lillicrap, which is actually getting legs now, I believe, to carry out a study with a large number of patients, over 500 patients, involving whole genome sequencing. That would perhaps settle this question once and for all.
Okay, so that is the quickest that we can do, the amount of information that has been given in the last 2 days. So hopefully we will see you again. Please pay attention for the newsletters, and we will try and keep the updates coming from the new therapies and new science.
Yes.
Thank you very much.
Tuned.
Bye.